Sigma is famous for their super sharp lenses with amazing build quality and have been making some very quirky cameras over the past couple of years. The Sigma FP is no exception to this story. They decided to create the smallest possible full-frame camera, and they obviously succeeded. Out of the box, it features a high-resolution 3.2-inch touch display, a 24-megapixel full-frame sensor with an L-Alliance mount, a microphone jack, a mini HDMI port, and a USB-C port. At the current latest firmware, which is a 2.0, it can shoot up to Ultra HD 12-bit 30fps RAW and Full HD 12-bit up to 100fps. Using the Sigma FP is slightly different than how you would use your traditional camera. Since it doesn't come with a grip, you have less surface to hold the camera with. I personally didn't have much problems with it, however, since the display of the camera is fixed and is unable to tilt, I hold my camera slightly higher than I normally do. The camera is also exceptionally light, making it super comfortable to have with you when traveling, which is one of the main reasons why I like the Sigma FP. Since the camera is meant to be a hybrid camera for both video and photo lovers, it features a handy dedicated button to switch between photo and video mode. I personally thought this would make switching between photos and videos very quick, however, because of software limitations, I'm still forced to change specific settings every time I switch between wanting to take photos or wanting to take videos. Which brings me to my next point. It is clear that Sigma doesn't have much experience in designing software for a camera compared to other brands such as Panasonic. In the Panasonic menu settings, I feel like there's no limitation whatsoever. Everything that I would possibly want to change is available through the many well-organized menu options. On the other hand, while I did get used to the locations of all the menu items after a while, I cannot get used to the controls of navigating through the settings. For example, press menu to go into the menu, press down, right to go into a submenu, and then press left to go back? No, press the menu button again. To go to the quick settings menu, you press the quick settings button, and to go into the deeper settings, you use the AL button. To go back from there, you have to use a normal menu button or the QS button again. It is quite a mess, and you would think that by using the touch controls, Sigma would have some intuitive navigation controls, such as using the GoPro. However, you are unable to use the touch controls to navigate or change any setting whatsoever. The only way that they enable the touch display is to zoom in with a double tap, which after you do, you're still not able to drag the magnification window. And you can also use the touch controls to choose your focus point. You would think that Sigma would spend extra time refining the touch navigation, since there aren't a lot of physical buttons on the camera. Especially since other companies already have this function for years. Hopefully, Sigma will introduce touch controls in later firmware versions, but at its current state, it's very disappointing compared to other brands. Although this is a hybrid camera focused for both stills and video lovers, it slightly leans more towards video capabilities. If you're a quality freak as I, and wants to have the most control over your video footage in post, then the Sigma FP is perfect for you. The Sigma FP is capable of filming 4K 12-bit RAW video to an external SSD, and is able to record up to 4K 8-bit RAW to an internal SD card. If you bought this camera to be as portable as possible like me, then you'll likely want to opt for recording to the SD card, which means you'll have to buy the largest and fastest currently available SD card, which is an SD card that can handle up to 300 MB a second write speed. As you may have guessed from this quirky camera, this means that the Sigma FP does not record compressed RAW, so your video files will get pretty big. It also has the ability to record compressed video format, however the footage will be sharpened quite a lot and you won't have as much flexibility as RAW footage. Unfortunately, the Sigma FP is not able to film above 30fps, so that means no 4K slow motion footage. Even with those limitations, I'm absolutely in love with the quality footage this camera can produce. Everything was filmed with a Canon 35mm f2.0 IS. The reason why I didn't go with the new compact Sigma lenses is because they're not stabilized, and the camera does not feature any in-body stabilization, which is obviously because of its small form factor. I personally think that a stabilized lens goes a long way so that you don't have to fix up the stabilization in post. For stills, most photographers will miss their viewfinder. I personally didn't use my viewfinder as much as my display on my GH5, so that was not a deal breaker for me, especially since it makes the whole camera a lot smaller. The photos that came out of the Sigma FP are very sharp and have really great color shines. I did notice that it's better to underexpose for highlights than to expose for the shadows, as the Sigma FP is more capable of recovering shadows compared to recovering highlights. Thanks to the high-resolution display, it makes it easy to double-check focus on your photos, which gives you a great chance to use one of the only touch functions of the camera. While this review may sound a little critical of the Sigma FP, this is by far my most favorite camera to bring with me when I'm filming or taking photos on my own time. If you're looking for a great hybrid camera that is very light and portable, and don't mind doing the extra post-processing work to make your raw footage work, then the Sigma FP is definitely the right choice. If you like this video, please like and subscribe and check out our website, word2buy.net. Thanks for watching.